Will homeowners elevate their homes on their own? Have we established an industry of architects and contractors that will continue to do this work? Are there loan options? Homeowners face hard decisions about losing space in their homes versus elevating, reducing risk and decreasing flood insurance rates. Even in situations where the full value of the construction and management of design and construction was funded by Build It Back, some homeowners elected not to do the work. For many homeowners, abandonment of ground floor and underground space is not a viable alternative to actual elevation due to the loss of rental income and the loss of valuable space that impacts future sale value. The city can continue to evaluate viable alternative mitigation measures and work to have these measures recognized in the setting of flood insurance rates. As the de Blasio administration continues to invest in building a more resilient city, we look for new ways and tools to promote the long-term resilience of New York's most vulnerable neighborhoods. It is our hope that the new task force will help the city and our residents better understand how we can utilize land use strategies to creatively and responsibly enhance coastal resilience. This new task force can learn from and expand on the extensive efforts already undertaken by the council, city agencies, and others to glean lessons learned from Hurricane Sandy recovery. For example, the final report of the Hurricane Sandy Houses of Worship and Charitable Organizations Recovery Task Force that was established by Local Law 18 and supported by Councilmember Traeger. The Department of City Planning's Resilient Neighborhood Studies, the Multifamily Flood Insurance Affordability Study commissioned by the Mayor's Office of Recovery and Resiliency, the Hurricane Sandy After Action Report and Recommendations, and Rebuild the Plain Now, Recommendations for Improving Government's Approach to Disaster Recovery and Preparedness, which was written by Holly Light, the former HUD Regional Administrator for New York and New Jersey. Although that's not an exhaustive list, these efforts cover some of the topic areas mentioned in Intro 1720A and will be useful starting points as the task force begins to consider recommendations. At this point, I'm available to answer questions.
Thank you, Director Peterson. I also want to note that we've been joined by Minority Leader Matteo. And before you arrive, Minority Leader, we gave a big shout out and thank you to the Staten Island Borough President for his leadership and really first calling for this, and we really want to appreciate that. So just to be clear, Director Peterson, and I appreciate your very, very thoughtful, informative comments and the testimony today. Does the administration support 1720A?
Yes, the administration supports 1720A.
That is much appreciated, and I would just note that there are a number of items, as you mentioned in the bill, that are important from us on a personal level that we've experienced in our districts personally. Mm-hmm. Certainly, many of the areas that you weighed out in your testimony, which I agree with, deserve examination. Language access is another issue that mm-hmm. you and I have talked about and seen firsthand in our communities. The ability to add capacity and greater partnerships with the nonprofit sector to take on some of these cases, case management. And I just want to read to you, and I want to add to the record the testimony of the Staten Island Borough President. There's a paragraph I think is really worth sharing out loud. That reads, as you move forward with the consideration of this legislation, I ask that the task force be assigned to focus on the housing end of the equation. In a few weeks, it will be 5 years since the storm struck, and we still have New Yorkers who have not returned to their homes. The housing part of the recovery, starting with the Rapid Repairs Program and continuing with Build It Back, has been the primary cause of angst for too many New Yorkers and resulted in a widespread loss of faith in government. My objective in the August 30th letter calling for the creation of this task force was to prompt an examination of the decisions that led to the Build It Back model of recovery, which predates the current administration, as opposed to alternative models such as voluntary acquisitions in the most vulnerable areas. And I thought that was really worth sharing out loud, because in our last hearing, we talked about some of these decisions before, and we'll get to examine those decisions before. And again, I thank you for navigating yourself it's a tough job, and I don't envy the position that you're in. And you and I have had some intense but also enlightening conversations, and I thank you for being a partner along the way. I just want to note if any of my colleagues have any other questions to the director. Council Member Bill Perkins, I'm sorry.
thank you very much for your presence. So 5 years and they have not returned to their homes?
So we are currently completing the Build It Back program. The majority of the people who are still in construction may have returned to their homes and then moved out for construction, but there are some people who haven't been in their homes since the storm.
And so how are they managing not living in their homes? And what alternative arrangements are they using or have been made to accommodate their needs? And how are they experiencing that? That's a long time to be out of your home.
Yeah, so one of the big decisions that this administration made, and I think needs to be thought about in a task force moving forward, is the decision to pay for rental assistance during construction. So when people have been have to relocate to take advantage of the elevation and rebuilding and the construction is ongoing, we reimburse people for their rental, and we actually can lease apartments for them. So that's been a big part of the program. The other piece that I think is really important for this task force to understand is the difference between those two groups of people, right? Who are people who never were able to return to their home versus people who returned to their home and then left their home to elevate or rebuild? And doing a better job, I think, of differentiating between those groups early on in the process.
So for those folks who were not able to return to their homes, give me an idea of a picture of what's happening with them, and how many of them are we talking about?
So I don't have the exact number because, as I said, the majority of the people that we're working with now are people who did return to their homes because of rapid repairs, and then were in the process to have their homes elevated, and so we're working with them. So the number of people who didn't return to their homes and have never been back in their homes is much smaller than that.
So those who have not been able to return, are they, who's in touch with them? Who's
so if they're in the Build It Back program, we work with them continually, and there's a lot of both nonprofit support and support from Build It Back to move forward.
So but you don't know how many of such people you're working with?
So I know how many people are in construction right now, but I don't know how many people never returned. And anyone who's in construction right now, which is, you know, almost everyone in our program is getting rental support. So at this point in time, everybody is getting rental support from us when they're under construction.
Okay, so when you say rental to support, what does that mean?
We pay their rent on
you
a monthly basis.
Fully their rent?
Yes.
And what are the range of those rents? Do you know by any chance?
So it is a higher level than the kind of standard fair market rent, and there are people in the audience who know this by heart. I don't know this by heart, but we can give it to you. But it's a fair rent based on the family size.
And just how are they doing?
So good. I mean, so one of the problems all along has been encouraging people to take advantage of our program, relocate for a period of time. And people have really wanted to stay in their communities or near their schools, and so we put in place a temporary housing services program, which works with Center for New York City Neighborhoods and NYDIS, and actually helps people rent apartments during that period of time, actually can lease apartments for them, and really works for people who have difficulties with that to make that happen.
Mm. Okay, so I have some other questions, but I'll... I'm sort of concerned about how are they doing, kind of a thing. Are they managing? Are they likely to return to?
So certainly the people who we're constructing new homes for and elevating homes for are returning home every day, and we've had a lot of people return home recently, and they're excited to be in what are, you know, safe homes that will protect them from future storms.
And what are the other challenges that they may be experiencing? Even as they're moving in the right direction, are they having some difficulties?
Yeah, so I mean, I think there's challenges for a lot of people who suffer from, who deal with storms, especially people who have kind of bad mortgage situations before the storm. And so those are some of the challenges that we work with. We have financial counselors and legal counselors to help them with that. And we've had a great partnership with the nonprofit community and the disaster case managers and NYDIS to help people with other needs that they have.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Sure, and great questions, colleague. I would just note that, you know, I'm in touch with some of those folks that you're speaking about. And, you know, one of the issues that we still have to work on now, but I hope the task force will also address is the issue of expanding capacity, because not many firms had the capacity or the expertise initially to deal with homes that are elevated or rebuilt, and plus we have homes that are attached, so there's kind of hard to elevate those types of properties. And so there's still, and I will credit the administration for agreeing to the temporary rental assistance, but the challenge has been also is finding a landlord that will grant you a 6-month lease or 8-month mm-hmm. lease when standard leases are longer. So, mm-hmm. but those are issues that we do plan to examine. I know that my colleague, Councilman Chaka, has questions.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you to this committee in partnership with Director Peterson and your staff. I think this task force I'm also very excited about, and really in the vein of in the spirit of the bill, that I just want to underscore that the report will include but not be limited to the analysis of, and then all the ideas that I think could have already been. But I think there's opportunities there to even grow that list, to really think about people that have been on the ground that can offer us new spaces to think about, to analyze. And I'm really happy that the chair started with lifting those who have been impacted by the recent hurricanes, and also thinking about the people in Mexico, because so much of what we're doing does not, this is not just about hurricanes, this is about the impacts to natural disasters that impact our lives and our homes, and the rebuilding and the recovery of neighborhoods in a city. And so I just want to say thank you. I hope that this can leave us with a legacy of commitment by a city and offer to other cities. Right now, and even thinking about everything that's coming back from Puerto Rico and the U.S. Virgin Islands, that can actually benefit from this. This is not just about New York City. This is really a global conversation that will continue to happen and allow governments, municipalities that are going to be on the ground more than any other governments, the opportunity to learn from. And so as someone who, I think all of us were on the ground after Superstorm Sandy, I think this is the right time to do it. No questions. Though I will say that I think it's an important thing to make sure that these reports are in multiple languages and that they are able to be digested into different communities. The day laborers have a big chapter in that immediate response. And so as we lift up all those who were there at the beginning, we need to make sure that not only do we honor that, but go back to them for that analysis. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilman Chaka. And yeah, the hope is that this report has the potential to shape changes to federal policy and rules and regulations. I mean, that's the goal here. It's really to cement these lessons learned into the form of changes to federal rules and policies. You and I have been to a number of meetings where we have to break the painful news to people that there are federal rules that prohibit certain things from happening, and it's frustrating. And it's not just in New York City, it's happening, I'm sure, across the country, that the same rules apply there too. And so this could be the blueprint for change across the land. If none of my colleagues have any questions, I think we're good. Thank you, Director Peterson. All right, I'd like to call up William Friedman from New York Legal Assistance Group, and Joseph, I think, from the Center for New York City Neighborhoods. I guess Mr. Friedman can begin.
Okay. Chair Traeger, council members and staff. Not coming through. Chair Traeger, council members and staff, good afternoon and thank you for the opportunity to speak to the Recovery and Resiliency Committee regarding the creation of a Hurricane Sandy Recovery Task Force. My name is William Friedman, and I am the acting director of the Storm Response Unit of the New York Legal Assistance Group, or NYLAG. NYLAG is a nonprofit law office dedicated to providing free legal services in civil law matters to low-income New Yorkers. NYLAG serves immigrants, seniors, the homebound, families facing foreclosure, renters facing eviction, low-income consumers, those in need of government assistance, children in need of special education, domestic violence victims, persons with disabilities, patients with chronic illness or disease, low-wage workers, low-income members of the LGBTQ community, Holocaust survivors, veterans, as well as others in need of free legal services. The Storm Response Unit focuses its assistance on victims of Sandy and provides assistance with legal issues arising from the storm. We are thrilled to learn that the committee is creating a task force on the lessons learned from Sandy. One of the paramount challenges facing Sandy victims was the lack of a sufficient disaster recovery infrastructure to respond to the catastrophic level of damage caused by the storm. It is only by thoroughly studying the Sandy recovery effort's successes and failures that we can properly prepare to address the challenges of future disasters. In the past few months, we've seen three more major weather disasters strike the United States. The ongoing effects of climate change will continue to increase the risk of all coastal areas within the country. We commend the committee on its mission to learn from Sandy and make the appropriate preparations for the unfortunate eventuality of another catastrophic storm striking the city. NYLAG Storm Response Unit has participated in assisting victims of Sandy since the first days after the storm. Although NYLAG was displaced from its Lower Manhattan office for 10 weeks, the agency established the Storm Response Unit within 48 hours of the storm, bringing its mobile legal help center to affected areas even before electricity was restored to many neighborhoods. Since then, NYLAG has continuously provided high-quality legal services in the area of disaster benefits, housing and foreclosure, homeowners and flood insurance, and consumer protection to victims of the storm. We have represented clients in over 13,000 legal matters and assisted these clients in accessing over $59 million in benefits. Disasters touch all aspects of life for those affected, and the issues are further compounded by the cross-section of federal, local, and private recovery resources. By fielding a team focused on disaster assistance, NYLAG Storm Response Unit has been able to respond to the needs of our clients. We've seen firsthand the struggles that our clients have faced throughout the recovery process, from the initial deployment of rapid repair to the creation of the Build It Back program and the many changes in direction the program would eventually take. We have also assisted our clients in related matters, including difficult insurance claims processes, loss of access to housing, and contractor fraud. We have quickly responded to changes in the landscape for survivors of the storm. For example, when FEMA announced in March 2015 that it would reopen all 144,000 national flood insurance claims, the Storm Response Unit immediately mobilized to assist affected clients. Similarly, NYLAG responded quickly to various announcements of clawbacks of federal and state funds that were allocated in the immediate aftermath of the storm. NYLAG Storm Response Unit remains the only free legal service provider in New York City that is still accepting new clients with Sandy-related issues. In addition to assisting our clients with the recovery process, we have recently partnered with the Center for New York City Neighborhoods to provide legal counseling on long-term resiliency-focused construction and flood insurance rates. We have remained committed to the idea of helping our clients reach a stable and permanent resolution to the problems caused by Sandy. As a leader in the field of storm recovery legal services, NYLAG's vast experience has been tapped recently by other states experiencing catastrophic storms. NYLAG has provided trainings to attorneys in Texas and Florida in relation to Hurricanes Harvey and Irma, and is working to reach colleagues in Puerto Rico as the island works to recover its basic infrastructure. NYLAG has also recently worked with Chief Judge Janet DeFiore's task force on legal assistance related to Hurricane Harvey. Given our past work on helping Sandy victims and our continuing commitment to creating a resilient city, we are pleased to be able to offer our expertise to the committee to either participate in the task force or open up our experience to other members of the task force. I want to thank Chair Traeger and the committees for holding this important hearing and continuing to focus on the mission of making New York City more resilient to future disasters. We look forward to continuing to work with the council and the mayor's office in these resiliency efforts.
Thank you, Arch. And we'll have a question, but after we hear the testimony from both sides, so please.
Good afternoon. My name is Joseph Sant, and I'm the Director of Homeowner Services at the Center for New York City Neighborhoods. I'd like to thank Committee Chair Traeger and members of the Committee on Recovery and Resiliency for holding today's hearing on the creation of a Hurricane Sandy Recovery Task Force. I'll say a little bit about the center. The Center for New York City Neighborhoods promotes and protects affordable home ownership in New York so that middle and working class families are able to build strong, thriving communities. We were established by public and private partners, including the City Council, and the center meets the diverse needs of homeowners throughout New York by offering free, high-quality services. Since our founding in 2008, our network has assisted over 40,000 homeowners with matters ranging from foreclosure prevention, post-Sandy repair and rebuild, flood insurance, and more. As an organization that advocates for residents in New York City's flood-prone neighborhoods, we applaud the proposed bill, and we support it. As we witness more severe storms battering cities and towns in Texas, Florida, and Puerto Rico, the U.S. Virgin Islands, the time is right to capture in a holistic way the many lessons we have learned as a city in the aftermath of Superstorm Sandy and operationalize those lessons so that we can better withstand and recover from future storms. We're appreciative that the proposed bill will create a task force that will include an analysis of the role of nonprofit organizations and the availability of legal services. The kinds of supports that are provided by nonprofit legal services firms, housing counselors, disaster caseworkers are critical components of disaster recovery. At the time Sandy hit, I was an attorney at Legal Services NYC, and I saw how the civil legal aid sector was one of the first responders to the disaster. Lawyers and paralegals, including my colleague Will here, were quick to establish clinics in communities hard hit by the storm so that residents could seek help with accessing federal benefits, filing insurance claims, and cutting through red tape to get insurance funds released quickly from mortgage banks. Housing counselors were also critical to helping homeowners get relief from paying their mortgages after the disaster, including accessing forbearance and preventing payment spikes when those forbearance periods ended. In 2013, thanks to support from the Mayor's Fund to Advance New York City, the center was able to provide more than $2 million in grant support to 19 housing counseling and legal services organizations located in the most impacted neighborhoods in Queens, Brooklyn, and Staten Island. And these investments in these on-the-ground providers kept these critical supports in place during the initial phase of housing recovery during the first year after Superstorm Sandy, serving over 3,500 residents. And this infrastructure has continued to serve New Yorkers throughout the recovery. In 2014, with support and oversight from the Mayor's Office of Housing Recovery Operations, we leveraged this same network of nonprofit legal providers and housing counselors to provide counseling assistance to homeowners in the Build It Back program. That network includes New York Legal Assistance Group, Neighborhood Housing Services of Brooklyn, Staten Island Legal Services, Brooklyn Legal Services, Mutual Housing Association of New York, CAMBA, and Mobilization for Justice, formerly known as MFY. These services have helped thousands of homeowners with many of the challenges associated with housing recovery, including foreclosure, dealing with unaffordable SBA loans, handling complex federal duplication of benefits requirements, negotiating with mortgage servicers to release their insurance funds, and for interested homeowners, navigating the acquisition process. We have focused on providing clear and accurate information about the rising cost of flood insurance and how to cope with changes brought on by new maps and federal reforms. And we've also provided advocacy services that help homeowners with disputing determinations that they disagree with. Over 4,000 homeowners have been counseled by this program, and counselors are available at help desks located at each of the Build It Back Construction Service centers to serve clients on demand and by appointment at our provider's local offices. The center has also had an opportunity to work with the city, and Amy Peterson mentioned this in her testimony, and the nonprofit sector to develop a nonprofit faith-based sector to develop a first-of-its-kind temporary housing services program for Sandy-affected homeowners undergoing long-term construction projects. And this is a joint effort with HRO, New York Disaster Interfaith Services, and the center. And this is responding to a need expressed especially by low to moderate income homeowners worried that they would not be able to afford temporary housing and would miss out on elevation or rebuild assistance. So this program helps homeowners find and pay for temporary rentals. A key aspect of this program is it directly pays rent so that rather than having homeowners advance funds and wait for reimbursement, they can have that rent paid directly, which is critical for cash poor households mid recovery. So there are many lessons that we've learned in the course of deploying these programs, but I think chief among them, first among them, would be the need for the city and nonprofit providers to integrate their efforts and achieve a high level of coordination as soon as possible. The level of coordination that we've reached at this stage of the recovery between nonprofits and city agencies is I think at this point very good, though there is always room for improvement. It took time and hard work to get to where we are. But the good news is if we study and learn from our current operations and our current models, in the event of another disaster like Sandy, we won't have to start from scratch. Do I have any time? Okay, I'll wrap up. I just wanted to also mention one other initiative, which is our Home Resiliency Audit Program. So this is a program that was funded with support from the Governor's Office of Storm Recovery. And for eligible homeowners, we'll send an engineer to the home to assess the home's risk of flooding and recommend mitigation measures. We worked with Dewberry Engineers to create a proprietary home resiliency technical review process that is designed to assess the kinds of residences and housing that is common to New York City's floodplain. And the engineer's technical review results in a report that explains to a homeowner their exposure to flood risk, recommends retrofits that would make the home more resilient against future storm damage, and generates a financial breakdown that shows the homeowner the potential benefits they may realize in terms of reduced flood insurance premiums. This program is available to 1 to 4 family homeowners, as well as multifamily building owners who are advised by our partner on the project community, Enterprise Community Partners. It's available in select neighborhoods that requested this program in their New York Rising plan. So I'll end there, and I just want to thank you very much for the opportunity to testify today. I'll end with one additional note, which is that while the center is engaged in many areas of recovery and resiliency, we don't claim to speak for anyone else in the city and the nonprofit sector, including our partners. There's a diversity of opinions among our agencies, and there are many agencies, including disaster case management, faith-based organizations, voluntary organizations active in disaster who are integral to recovery as well, and their viewpoints are very important to represent in any analysis. So we look forward to continuing to work with you on this.
Thank you very much. And just to follow up, when do you expect the process to expand to other neighborhoods with the Home Resiliency Audit Program?
Beginning in November, at the start of November, we'll be relaunching Flood Help NY, which is the portal where homeowners can sign up for these services. It'll be opened up to the initial neighborhoods of Coney Island, Brighton Beach, Seagate, Manhattan Beach, Garrettson Beach, and Sheepshead Bay. Right.
This was born out of the New York Rising program.
That's right.
Right, and yeah, as many areas of Southern Brooklyn were initially not a part of it, but we had to explain why. It's thank you for that. Question for NYLEG, and we thank you for your partnership. Will NYLEG is NYLEG, but will NYLEG assist Build-It-Back participants with filing like Article 78 petitions during their appeal process of certain decisions?
That we would not, based on our legal counseling relationship with the Center for New York City Neighborhoods and the Build-It-Back program in and of itself. It's a step beyond what we'd be able to do. I think we're able to steer applicants towards relatively constructed paths in which to challenge decisions that they disagree with and help them put together the best presentation of those ideas so that the program can understand what the issues are and try to separate it a little bit from the let's say hostility that people will have, because it is of course their home and they're disagreeing with issues of their home. But assisting them with litigation would be something beyond what we can do.
So what if they lack the capacity to file such a petition, financially speaking?
Yeah, it's definitely a very difficult process in Article 78, and there's a very fast turnaround. It's a 4-month statute of limitations generally. So there's not a lot of time for individuals to seek alternative assistance. So if somebody has a particular need, we have many pro bono partners. We can try to send people to the Bar Association to get further advice, but it's beyond something that we would be able to assist them with.
And do you have a list of legal organizations that can provide them assistance?
In terms of direct legal organizations, unfortunately, there are no other free legal services organizations that are taking on Sandy-related cases. So it was really up to the private bar and or taking pro bono cases from the private bar to assist these applicants.
So this is a little bit concerning because there are some folks who are going through a difficult time and lack the means, but this is something I'd like to follow up on separately outside this hearing. We'll call on next my colleague, Councilmember Ulrich.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you both for your testimony. I want to thank you for the good work that NYLEG and Center for New York City Neighborhoods has done in my district, in the Rockaways, and in particular on the communities on the mainland. Hamilton Beach, I know, has benefited greatly from the legal assistance that NYLEG has provided. I actually have a question for Mr. Sant regarding the audit program that's funded, the Home Resiliency Audit Program. I think I'd spoken to one of your colleagues several months ago, Rachel, is that?
Yeah, she's our deputy director. Yeah,
all right, so at the time I expressed concern that Broad Channel was not included in this program. And
that's right.
And then I see the list of communities that you're expanding to, Brighton Beach, Seagate, Coney Island, Manhattan Beach, Garrison Beach, Sheepshead Bay. I still don't see Broad Channel on the list.
Right.
Why is Broad Channel excluded from the audit program when that was a community that the bay and the ocean, like, completely submerged the community underwater? It was one of the hardest hit neighborhoods in my district, hands down.
Sure, sure, yeah. And we would love to serve the residents of your district. The way that the program, which is a pilot program, is funded is through the New York Rising Program's participatory budgeting process. I can't give you all the details about how that process worked, but communities in geographic boundaries that were set forth by the Governor's Office of Storm Recovery formed committees, voted on what services they would like to have in their neighborhoods. And so if the community voted for residential technical assistance, we're able to basically, they made a choice to put funding towards that program. We're able to serve those neighborhoods. If that program were to be voted into another district's plan, we would be able to serve them as well.
So one of the people who served on that committee, Mr. Mundy, was very active in my district on resiliency issues and other, he's the civic president, coincidentally. You know, I remember the time they voted or recommended that the New York Rising money be set aside for the New York, for the Sunset Cove project, among several other minor capital projects in that area. But it's a small community, and it wouldn't take a lot of money or extra personnel to expand this home audit program that you're providing to almost every other neighborhood in the city that's being, that was affected by Hurricane Sandy, to expand it to Broad Channel, even though they technically may not have voted for that portion of the New York Rising ballot or whatever it was. You're probably only talking about, at this point, maybe 100, maybe even less, because the people have already gotten elevation certificates, they've already gotten surveys done, they're already halfway through, almost done with the Build It Back program. God willing, they'll all be done soon. So it's not like you're talking about you'd have to do the whole town.
Right.
I just think that with the amount of money that these nonprofit groups are getting, my philosophy is if you do it for one, you should do it for everyone and not just do it for some. And Broad Channel is a community that was severely impacted by the storm. And that's not to say that these other neighborhoods that you're serving were not also impacted, but Broad Channel, the two bodies of water literally met, you know, at the elevation of 5 feet,
right,
in the middle of Cross Bay Boulevard. And I just want to make sure that Broad Channel, when you expand this pilot program, that you would consider going into Broad Channel. It is so important that the homeowners there don't fall through the cracks, because they are going to get crushed by
skyrocketing flood insurance premiums when Biggert's Waters Act expires and when all the news cameras stop covering Hurricane Sandy anniversaries 5 years from now, the working class and the middle class people in Broad Channel, and I won't be in office by then, I'm term limited, but the working class and the middle class people in Broad Channel, they're going to get screwed on their insurance rates. And so if there's any way to help them through a program like this, and it wouldn't cost us a lot of money, please, please take that back to your higher-ups at Center for New York City Neighborhoods. I'm pleading with you. This is important, and we really can't leave anybody behind.
I hear you, and yeah, my commitment will explore every funding funding avenue available to expand a Broad Channel. If it's not through the GOSER New York Rising process, we'll look at other options as well. And
thank
happy
you.
To keep
thank you very. I appreciate it. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Thank you.
No, and I thank you, my colleague, and it raises a very good point. You know, we learned in recent testimony in previous hearings that apparently over 80% of homeowners, property owners who are paying flood insurance might be overpaying flood insurance based on outdated information, and some folks are not aware about the elevation certificate that can be used to potentially lower their premiums once they provide it to their insurance company. And but that piece of paper is not cheap, and that's the issue. And so I do want to echo that I do think that this is a very valid issue, and I want to offer my support to my colleague that we need to help all impacted communities. If there are no other questions, Councilmember Perkins.
I just want to, you know, I represent a more urban area, and so what are the challenges in terms of resiliency in neighborhoods like Harlem, where we have a substantial number of homeowners, brownstones and the like? Do we have these resiliency challenges as well, or that's a phenomenon that is outside of those type of neighborhoods, with some of them in the Bronx, somewhere in the Bronx as well?
I'd be happy to try to answer that. So I think every neighborhood has both common challenges and unique challenges. One way that individual building owners can learn about their flood risk and what they should be concerned about is to go to floodhelpny.org. It's a citywide resource. Any building owner in New York City can access that, punch in their address, and understand if their flood zone is changing. And this is happening throughout many of the coastal neighborhoods and sometimes farther inland than you'd expect, where they might be moving from what FEMA considers a moderate risk zone to a high risk zone. That's happening in certain neighborhoods, including Lower Manhattan. So it's not, Manhattan's not untouched. To know for sure, you could go to Flood Help NY, find out. We do offer, through Enterprise Community Partners as well, a multifamily building resiliency audit. Mm-hmm. So you know, we don't just focus on 1 to 4 at the center. That's our focus, but our partners are able to provide the same process, send a building engineer out, do a technical assessment. Some of the issues are the same, some of them are different. We know that a lot of the multifamily building owners are primarily concerned with continuity. Are their power systems going to be in place if there's another storm? How long is it going to take to get that back? And there's a lot more options for multifamily building owners to sort of lower operating costs and become more resilient at the same time. So I would certainly encourage any of the building owners in your district to look into that as well.
Thank you very much. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, colleague. And if there are no other questions, this hearing is adjourned. Thank you.